Good morning, New Life family. We are so excited you joined us today. Our hope and our prayer is that you receive exactly what you need from this word, from this worship experience. We have been praying for you. We are just grateful that you decided to be a part of the New Life community on this beautiful Sunday morning. My name is Ayana Taylor, and I have the pleasure of welcoming you into the room. Even though you're joining us from your living room, your bedroom, maybe at work, you are just as important, just as present as the people in this room today. If you are a first-time visitor, if this is your first time being a part of our worship experience, we would love to know. Let us know in the chat and maybe share where you're joining us from, especially if you're outside of the Metro Atlanta area. We would love to know. Also, if you'd like to grow deeper with our church, you'll have an opportunity to do that at the end of service. There will be a link dropped in the chat. You'll click that link. It'll take you to a Zoom room where you'll meet some of our leaders here at this church that can share with you what we're doing here, what we're creating in this community. And also, if you'd like to grow deeper in your faith with your relationship with Christ, you'll have the opportunity to talk to someone who can guide you through it, who can pray with you. So take that opportunity today. And if you have not already, please register for our virtual online community. This is our eCampus. It is a space for you to grow with others that are virtual members as well. You also will be able to be a part of ministry virtually, get notifications about what's happening in our church, because your membership, your presence is just as important as the people in the room. To prepare our hearts and minds for service today, I'd love to share a scripture from Philippians 4:4-7. It says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus." So today we will rejoice. We will worship God for what is right in our lives. We will express gratitude. Our worship from our lips to God's ears is so imperative. It shifts our thinking from what is wrong to what is right in our lives. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you. We thank you for this beautiful Sunday. We thank you, Lord, that we are springing forward today. We are creating space for new vision, new dreams, new opportunities. The seeds that have been planted in previous seasons will blossom today. I pray, God, that you open our ears to hear the word that is just for us. I pray, Lord, that as we celebrate Women's History Month, we reflect on just how powerful, just how confident we are and can be through Christ Jesus. I thank you, Lord, that we have the opportunity to be with you today. Receive our worship. We love you, God. We worship you, Lord. We say thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. And today we have a special treat. We will be talking to the icon, Xernona Clayton. And you need to share this with your friends. Let them know that they can be a part of this experience as well.
sense that God is madly in love with you. He loves you in spite of you, in spite of your mess, your mistakes. He loves you in spite of what you've done, what you think, where you've gone. He loves you. I've made so many mistakes in my life, I didn't think anybody would want me, that God couldn't get anything out of me. Have you ever been there where you've been so lost and so confused and so hurting that you don't think there's any hope for you at all? And lo and behold, Jesus comes and nudges you on the shoulder and says, I still have a plan for you.
Come on in this house and give God praise. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Hallelujah. How many glad to be in the house of the Lord today? How many glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Did anybody come expecting God to do something great this morning? How many of you are looking for the Lord to do something great? Well, that's a good thing, because God's in the great doing business. He does all things well. So come on and celebrate the name of the Lord. Take a moment and greet your neighbor that's sitting or standing next to you, and greet them if you would. And those of you joining us online, welcome to each of you. So glad you're with us this morning online. We thank God for you. What an amazing experience we're getting ready to have. Hallelujah. 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 All right. So the Bible says, oh, come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise unto the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with singing and praise our God. Anybody know that our God is worthy of singing and praise? That he's worthy of honor and worship? There is nothing in your life that you're going through right now that God is not in charge of. I promise you, when you think it's at its worst, that's when God is at his best. If you would dare to worship him, if you would dare to get in the presence of God, you set an atmosphere for the Lord's presence to come. The Bible says that he inhabits the praises of his people. That means when you praise God, his presence shows up. So I don't know what you're dealing with or wrestling with or struggling with, but the good news is that our God is here. Our God is available, and our God is worthy of praise. So we clap our hands to worship him. We lift our voices to worship him. We bless his name because he's worthy. Father, we honor you and bless you. We give you glory. We thank you, oh God, for being who you are. We pray even now that you will search every heart, that you will solve every issue, heal every dilemma. I pray, God, that we would be sensitive to your presence, that you would be in our midst even now. We thank you, oh God, that the enemy is defeated and Jesus is Lord. In Jesus' name, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, saints of God, bless the name of the Lord, for he is good.
Good morning, New Life, hallelujah. The Bible says, who is like unto the Lord our God? There is nobody greater, nobody better, nobody stronger, hallelujah. So let's give God, who is worthy of our praise, all that we have this morning, amen. Let's go. Come on, put your hands together, New Life.
Many places and many things. celebrated. Sweet drink I've tasted, they've come and gone.
Stronger.
Let him be stronger.
If he's higher.
If he's higher.
greater, let him be greater. The problem with us is we're not letting him be who he is. You're stifling him with your doubt and your fears, and you're stopping him from being the great God that he is. If he's great, let him be great. If he's strong, let him be stronger. Is there anybody here that knows that he's greater and stronger and mightier than anything in your life? Then come on, let's sing it. If he's greater, let him be greater. All ye people, and shout unto God with the voice of triumph. Father, we love you and honor you because you are great and you are strong and you are mighty. There's no one like you. You sit on the circle of the earth. You're the sovereign God who's in charge of our lives. We pause this morning to say thank you. Thank you for your mercy in our life. It's new every morning. Thank you for your grace and goodness. And Lord, even when we don't deserve it, you are still good. Father, we honor you now for the breath we have in our body, for the use of our limbs. We thank you, God, that we are alive. We're able to lift our hands in your presence. We pray that your spirit would meet us here, that you would be with us throughout our time together in worship. I ask you now that you would make your presence known. In the matchless and mighty name of the Lord Jesus, and we give your name praise in Jesus' name. And all the people of God shouted and said, hallelujah, 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 amen, and amen again. Come on and bless the name of the Lord. You may take your seat in the presence of God. What a great God we serve. It's beautiful to be in the house of the Lord today, isn't it? Amen. Look at your neighbor and tell him, I'm glad to be with you. I'm glad to be with you. If this is your first time with us in worship this morning, we'd love to recognize you. Just wave your hand at us if this is your first time with us in a New Life worship experience. Amen. 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 If you're watching online, we just want to give a big, big welcome to you. Thank you for being present and being here. We know you have so many options online to watch, but we're honored that you would watch here and worship with us as a family. To our virtual online community, we thank God and we love you. No matter where you are, in the city, in the country, and even around the world, would you put that in the chat space? If you are not watching from the city of Atlanta, or if you're watching anywhere at all in the country or around the world, put it in the chat space so we can greet you properly. We're just glad to have you with us. You are a part of our church family, and we're honored about it. Come on, New Life, will you help me thank God for all of our online worshipers this morning, those who are worshiping with us online. Well, today we are celebrating Women's History Month, and this is our Women's Emphasis Sunday, and I could not be more excited to have with us as our special guest, Mrs. Xernona Clayton, the incomparable Xernona Clayton. Would you help me give a big, big, big welcome? Really let her know how happy we are that she's with us today. So, this week is the 1 year anniversary of her statue. She is the only African-American woman who has been granted a statue in the downtown Atlanta area. Isn't that a big honor? And this is the week a year ago, so we're celebrating Women's History Month, and we're celebrating that statue erection. We thank God for her service and her work, and you're going to hear a lot more from her today. She brought several friends with her, so if you are with Miss Clayton, or if you are invited and you came to be a part of that, and you're a guest, we want you to stand up so we can recognize you. If we could get a little light on them, it would be great. Come on, New Life, let's give us really, really big, big welcome to our guests. Amen. Well, we've got a lot going on at our church, and I need to pause and give a big shout out to the men that came on yesterday for our Kingdom Conversation. Come on, come on. Thank God for our men, your husbands, your fathers, your brothers. Amen. Amen. I was so proud of our guys on yesterday and how you came and you celebrated, but you also learned, and the questions were amazing. The interchange and the dialogue was just very rich. I am grateful to God that we have a church that's hungry for growth, and to see that many men in the room on yesterday just did something to my heart that I can't begin to describe. It was phenomenal. I want to thank Minister Kevin Taylor for being our men's ministry leader and leading us so, so well. Thank you, Kevin. Thank you so much. And we had several of our elders that were on our panel on yesterday, and my thanks to each of them for the breadth of wisdom that was displayed on yesterday. If you missed it, please go back and watch it. It'll live on YouTube for as long as the internet is the internet. So you can go back and watch it and be blessed by it. Amen. Let's give our guys, let's give our men another hand. Amen. A lot's happening in this upcoming week. We're very excited about it. I'm going to be turning 26 this week. So I turn 26 again on this week. And so my birthday is this week. I'm excited about that. Amen. I thank God for it. I thank God for it. But also, we are honoring the Lord for this coming Tuesday. We're having our job fair, and we're going to be sponsoring. And I said that it was going to only be the People Shores, which is our own workforce development data center on the third floor. However, we have invited a list of employers and companies that are going to be on site, and there are over 20 companies, everyone from Delta to the United States Post Office to several others that are going to be here. So if you know individuals, yourself or others, who are looking for work, unemployed or underemployed, or just don't like where you are employed, we'd love to have you here with us for this job fair. It's going to be a blessing to have that many organizations and companies in a room. And we have made a commitment. We have a full job center here at our church. And our commitment in our job center is that if a company comes, they must come with the full intent to hire even that day on the spot. That is our commitment. And I am just excited that they're doing that. Many of you toured our data center on last Sunday for People Shores, and I want to thank you so much for taking the time after services to make that tour upstairs on the third floor. We are so proud of the work that the Alliance is doing, and we're just honored that you are a part of that. Thank you for being a part of it. Well, I want to mention that our dream campaign is underway, and so many of you have given so much in support of it. Amen. Amen. Last year and the first 2 months of this year, you've already given nearly $500,000 to our dream campaign. Come on and let's give God praise for it. So I want to remind you again that if you're a member of our church or you're a friend of our church and you're committed, I want to encourage you to make certain that you give to Dream. Dream enables us to revitalize this immediate community, building homes and houses and affordable and income-based housing for individuals who live here. You all know that gentrification is coming. And we're not anti-gentrifist at all, but we want to make certain that it's done smartly and right. And we believe that if anybody's coming in our community, they need to stop by New Life first and make sure that this is the place that we want them to be, that they want to be. So we're making certain that we are protecting legacy residents who live in this community. And they don't have to move out or prices are going to go up 2 and 3 times. And that happens in the course of one lease agreement. So I'm asking you to please be faithful in giving to Dream. It enables us to mitigate those effects by building our own homes and our own income-based housing so we can protect those who live in this area. And even if it's only one family, that's one family that doesn't have to leave. Amen. Amen. Excited about our warming station? Amen. We praise God for it. So since the winter has started, this number sounds unbelievable, and I know it's going to be difficult for you to believe. Since the winter started, not in unique people, these are repeat individuals, but in stays, the number of beds that have been occupied over the entire winter now has reached 1,000 occupants. 1,000 occupants over the entire winter, the number of beds. I know, that sounds unbelievable, but it is absolutely amazing. Night after night after night after night, there are 50 and 60 people that are a part of our warming station, and I'm so grateful to God, to you as a church, that you enable us to do that. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for enabling us to do that. Well, we're getting ready for our 5K run walk, and I want to be certain that you get registered. It's going to be on April the 20th, and April the 13th and the 20th, we're having two run walks, two 5Ks. One is virtual. So those of you that don't live in the city of Atlanta, or you are in a different part of the country, or even a different part of the world, and you want to participate in our 5K, you can go in your subdivision, a park close by your home. You can run your 5K right there. Just record your run and record your stats, and be sure to send them in through ChronoTrack, which is the track that we're using. Or on the 20th, you can come out and be a part of the 5K in person. It's going to be right here on our grounds, and we're going to run around our entire community, like Joshua and the children of Israel marching around the walls of Jericho, except we're not going to do it 7 times. We're going to do it one time. And we're going to run in this community, and we're going to make certain that God is honored and praised. So if you are interested in registering, I need you to do that today, right away. There's a QR code that should be on the screen. Please scan that QR code. If you're watching, it should be on your television screen. Please scan that QR code so that you can get registered to be a part of our 5K. 100% of all the proceeds goes into our alliance and all of the outreaches and services and ministries that you hear us talking about Sunday after Sunday. And all God's people said, amen. Well, let's give God praise for all that's happening here at our church. We honor the Lord for it. It's giving time. It's time to bless God with our tithes, our offerings, and our dream campaign. We give twice here at New Life. The first time we give is for our tithes and offerings. The second time we give is for our dream campaign. I'm praying that you will honor the Lord with the tithe. The tithe is the Lord's, it's not ours. Now, I want to be very clear that the tithe has nothing to do with your salvation. Jesus and his death on the cross is the reason why you're saved. It has nothing to do with you going to heaven if you don't give tithes. Amen. The tithe is not about heaven. It's actually about earth. It's about the level and quality of your life that you live here on earth. As you are generous and as you sow seeds in the kingdom, so the Lord returns blessings into your home and your house. And the Bible says that you won't have room enough to receive it. And so we honor the word of God with our tithing. And then we ask you to go back into Push Pay a second time and to give towards our dream campaign. You'll need to select that drop down specifically to give to Dream. Select that drop down in the Push Pay online giving option. Select the Dream campaign and give your offering. Many of you give to Dream every week, and many of you are giving to Dream and once a month. But however you give to Dream, we're grateful to God that you do that. Amen. Father, I pray that you would touch your people today, that as we give, that you would honor the gift. Lord, do we give of your blessings in our own life? And Father, we know that when we give to your work, you always touch our homes and households. Pray your grace would flow over those who give today, that you would honor every house, honor every gift, and honor every giver. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And the people of God said amen and amen again. There are three ways you can give here at our church. The first, of course, is going to our website. If you go to our website, it enables you to give. You can simply go to newlife-atl.org. And if you would click on the giving tab at the top right corner, it'll enable you to give. Secondly, you can text to give. You simply text the word NewLifeATL to the number 77977, and you can give through that method. And then for many of you that are watching and that are at home, you can always send in your gifts if you choose to do that. You can send them in to the addresses on the bottom of your screen. And also, if you're in the room, there's a fourth way that you can give, and that is by using the envelopes in the seat back covers just in front of you. If you would reach over and grab an envelope, it's just in front of you. And if you don't see one, an usher can make certain that you get an envelope to give, and you're welcome to place your gift on the inside. We don't pass a bucket here at our church, and so at the end of service, you're welcome to drop your gifts off in the tithing offering receptacles that's just at all of the exit doors. You're welcome to do that. Let's all, as a family now, let's take a quick moment and let's take out our smartphones or our devices and let's all give together as a family. Those envelopes are in front of your seat backs. You would take them out, prepare your gifts. It is just that simple. Amen. Thank you so much for your generosity. Thanks for giving. Well, today we are celebrating Women's History Month, as I mentioned earlier, and we're excited to have with us Xernona Clayton. We're just honored that she's with us this morning, and we're going to be bringing the message a unique way today. We're going to interview her and hear about her life and her relationship with humanity and with God and how God is so touched her life and blessed her to do the things that she's been able to accomplish throughout her life. She doesn't want me to say it, but she's 93 years young. Young. 93 years young. And the lady you're going to meet has been so preserved by the Lord. So preserved by the Lord. The Bible talks often about satisfying us with long life. And that is exactly what the Lord has done for her. And long life is not length. It's also quality. It's quality. You can live a long time and do a little bit. It's the quality of life. I'm so inspired. Young ladies that are here, young girls that are in the room, you're about to meet someone that you need to mark down as a role model and a hero. Much of the freedoms and experiences that you experienced as a young woman in this culture was trailblazed by Xernona Clayton. We celebrate all of the great athletes and all the great businesswomen and all of the great scientific women and the great minds that are alive today, but they are there because they're standing on her shoulders. And so we honor her presence and we thank God that she's with us today. I'm praying that you would open your heart to hear what the Lord would have you to hear in our time of worship today. Would you do that? Amen. Well, before we sing, I want us to have just a quick moment of prayer. My heart is absolutely broken. In the midst of all of this celebration, I do need to bring us some tough news. Our beloved Reverend Eric Robertson went home to be with the Lord on last night. And he had been battling an illness for a while. And Reverend Robertson is the Robertson family. They are so precious. They're absolutely precious. He was the longest serving minister on our ministerial staff. Whenever there was hardly any other ministers here but me and him and maybe one or two others, Reverend Robertson served so faithfully, so diligently. He served as a men's ministry leader in our church, of course, a preacher and a teacher in our church. And he is so deeply loved and will be so deeply missed. 2023 and now 2024 has just been a tough, tough year of some pretty significant losses in our church family. But we know that our God is the comforter of every broken heart. That God comforts us in our tears, and he will wipe all of our tears away. So, Father, I thank you that Eric Robertson loved you, served you, and honored you with his life. I thank you, God, that you have called him home to his reward. And now he is in your presence. He is honoring your name forever and ever. I pray that you would keep his family. Keep Veronica and touch her. Allow your hand to be over her life. As she grieves, I pray that you would be the constant companion that walks beside her. I pray for his family, his children, for those who honored and loved him. Love never dies, even when life stops. So we ask you now, God, that you would wrap your arms around them. Let your love and your grace overshadow them in the name of Jesus. Then cover our church. And Lord, even as our hearts are broken, may we find solace and comfort in the will and power and the hand of our gracious and loving God. We give your name praise in Jesus' name. Amen and amen again. Many of you may not have known Reverend Robertson, but I tell you, you missed knowing a wonderful and beautiful soul. Would you help me give God thanks for the life of Eric Robertson? Help me honor his life. Father, we thank you, God. We honor his life. We honor his commitment, his dedication to you. We honor you. Praises to our God. Let us worship together with our women's choir. Thank you.
Oh,
out to him this morning. Time, just the voices. You're worthy of it all.
You to take a moment and think of all the things that God is worthy of in your life. The blessings that he's given to you and forgiveness that he's extended your life. The fact that you live a life of favor. I want you to consider all that God is worthy of. Hands raised. Just sing that one more time. You're worthy of it all.
You're worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve glory.
You're worthy. One more time, you're worthy of it.
You're
worthy of it all. You're worthy of it all. So, Father, you are worthy. All the glory and all the honor. We bless you. We do declare that you are great. In Jesus' name. Amen. And amen again. Would you give the Lord praise? Take your seat if you can. You may take your seat. Well, today we're honored to have Ms. Clayton with us, and there's a short video that we'd love for you to watch. Sort of reminds us of what today is about. We're asking young ladies everywhere to not doubt yourself, your abilities and your strength, but to show up in life. Bring all that you are to everything that you do. Bring all that you are to everything that you do. So we would love you to give attention to this video, and then we'll have Miss Clayton join us on stage. You are on time for everything.
Oh, everything.
Everything.
Everything. The 12 o'clock news, you got to come on at 12:20.
That's right.
And he said, I love this woman. He said, I'd do anything in the world for her. And he said, if I found her caught in a burning building,
wow,
I'd go in to retrieve her.
Wow.
And then he said to my husband, of course, you'd do the same thing when her husband's eight or either both of us. Going in the burning building.
Either both of us going in there. You're going to go in, and I'll stay out here.
Right. Young lady, from this day forward, I don't care who you have a date with. If you tell them you're gonna meet them on the corner of the street, and y'all gonna count blue cars that pass by, as unimportant as that sounds, young lady, you show up.
And all God's people said amen. Please join me in welcoming Ms. Xernona Clayton to our platform and Mr. Hank Stewart. Mr. Hank Stewart. Give both of them another good hand, please. Amen. Get her mic together just there. All right. So I want to introduce Mr. Hank Stewart. Hank is a dear friend of Ms. Xernona Clayton, and I wanted him to join us in this interview. He knows her so well, and they've been connected for many, many, many years, and I wanted him to be a part of this experience. Hank, tell me when you first met Miss Clayton.
He's a lot older than I am.
He's a lot older than you are.
Wow. It's been at least, I worked for Reverend Jesse Jackson back in 2000, and Miss Clayton and Reverend Jackson are very good friends, and we were putting on a gala. The Rainbow Push Gala, and she came through, and she is as more beautiful now than she was then, and she was absolutely gorgeous then.
Yes.
And, but it wasn't just her external beauty, it wasn't the outer beauty, it was the inner beauty. It's treating anybody that comes up to Miss Clayton, she makes you feel like you're the most important person
yes.
in the world.
Yes, yes.
She gives you their undivided attention, and she talks to you.
Yes.
I had the luxury of performing for Michelle Obama once, and I never forget being in the room with her, how she gave you eye-to-eye contact. And I said, she must have got that from Miss Clayton, because Miss Clayton makes sure that you know that you're important. And I fell in love with her then. So it's been at least about almost 25 years now.
Wow.
Almost 25 years.
And I know your life has been the better because of it.
Because of it.
So Miss Clayton, you've done so much in your life. You've impacted the film world. You've impacted civil rights. You've had an impact on CNN. You've done so much in your life. I want you to introduce yourself to the young ladies and the women in the church who may not know you. Kind of walk us through in a short context a little bit of your life. What does your resume look like?
Well, I really like the way he's talking about me. I'd like to hear him a little more. Well, first I want to say, Reverend, how delighted I am to be here to meet you and your wife. But I want to tell this congregation before I start that when we drove up here today, my sister drove me and we were looking for the right place to park. And we saw the man who's guarding the grounds, I guess. And he told me something about you. He said he came here to accept a job. He's been here years since. Because once he saw what you and your church are doing for the people, he said he had to join. Now that's a great tribute to you, your wife, and all these people who are sitting here. You know, you just didn't put up a building. You're helping people. And I'm so happy I'm in this place. I really am.
Oh, we're honored, honored, honored.
Now what was it you asked me? I forgot.
I wanted you to talk about you, to tell us a little bit of your life journey, a little bit of your journey. When did you get started working with the civil rights movement with Dr. King and SCLC?
Well, first I want you to know
and I want to make sure
everybody
that you can be heard. Do we have a handheld mic? You can hear her fine? Okay, all right, perfect.
I want everybody to know one thing about me, that I am absolutely the most blessed person in the world.
Wow. Wow.
The good Lord has blessed me bountifully. And I tell people, I cannot be ugly to other folk because too many people are nice to me. I have with me this morning something that's not unusual. Every place I go, I mention it. I've got people who I know they got something else to do, but they act like they don't have nothing else to do but just follow me. They go to support me every place I go.
Wow.
Not just Atlanta, they're going to the Bahamas soon, but I think they like to travel too, you know. And I show them a good time, but they still follow me. And they're here this morning. But Reverend, I was first blessed to be born in a wonderful home. mother and a father who cared about our growth and development. I think we've lost that now, you know, today when I see a mother, her son is on his way to jail because he's been doing wrong. She said, oh, he was such a good boy. Well, how good could he have been if he's on his way to jail? You know, how good was he? So I kind of reflect retrospectively of that good home I came from, because my mother and father were serious. Yeah. I mean, my father gave the lectures, my mother pulled the switches off the tree in the backyard. And so we knew right from wrong. And even when we tried to explain it,
right,
it didn't work.
Right.
You know, so those whippings came. But I have had the most blessed life. I couldn't be mean to folk if I tried. I really couldn't, because I'm too blessed.
Yes.
I remember, oh, you all are some nice people here. I think I'm gonna stay here.
I want you to stay.
But I remember going to college. It's interesting how some painful moments in your life you just never forget. I'd been a pretty decent girl, well, mother and daddy made us that way. But I was a senior in high school, I mean in college, and I had, when I talk in plural, because I'm a twin, identical twin who I still miss, but we did everything together, and the Lord blessed us both. She ended up, you know, has passed away now. But we went out from college one night on a date, and on the way back to the dormitory, I was my boyfriend, and my sister was her boyfriend. The four of us stopped because we wanted hamburger before going in to the dorm. And there's one right there. So we stopped, and we happily went in. All of us had money. We went in and walked into this man, had a butcher knife. It had to be this long, you know, looked like 3 feet long. And he said, he picked that knife up and said, you niggas get out of here. You know you don't belong here. I'll cut your heads off if you don't get out. Now, I'm telling you, I think I've lied so much by my age. I really don't know how old I am, but. But that was a long time ago. And I remember the words still ringing in my ear, you don't belong here. That hurt. But what it did, it put me on the right track for my life's work. Put me on the right track. Because from that day to this, I've put myself in places where I know I belong. I belong in the house of the Lord. I belong in the line of people who are hungry, so I can help feed them.
That's right.
I built a school in Africa because children had no schools to go to.
That's right.
And then I found out that they couldn't get fresh running water. And I said, no water fountains? And in my tours, I'd been seeing women washing clothes out of the dirty water in the creek, washing dishes in the dirty creek. And I said, oh, I've got to have fresh water. They said, well, we don't have any electricity. Well, you know, I'm kind of ignorant also. I didn't know where electricity came from. So I said, well, let's find some. Because we got to have water, fresh water. Well, they didn't have any. But I kept on, because I don't go away easily and quietly. But guess what? I was so thrilled when after all my begging and pleading that I got water, but just not just for my children, but for 25,000 citizens who live there. Now, if that had made you, you know, feel encouraged to do more and more, and I'm a beggar, you know, so I'm coming out here to help you all feed, because I understand you all got a great feeding program. I love to feed folk.
Yes.
And share the blessing that I have some food.
That's right.
I want to help other folk. It's just in me that I want to do that. But along the way, from that man saying you don't belong here, see, I was born black, but what he didn't realize is what Dr. King said. All of us, every living soul, we all came from the same place.
That's right.
You know, the stork came down and put all of us on somebody's front porch, you know. And then, from there, you had to do something, you know. And so, I've learned now that to be thankful for where I am, and I do belong here.
That's right.
I didn't decide to be black, but I'm proud that I am.
That's right.
Yeah.
I didn't choose to be a woman, but boy, it feels good to put lipstick on and buy some clothes sometimes.
Ms. Clayton, you have done so much, and you know, there are some quotes that I think about when I think about you. One is a quote that says, black women seldom do what they want to, but they always do what they have to. Powerful statement. Had to be talking about you. Dr. Jeanetta Cole once says, you can educate a man, you educate an individual, you educate a woman, you educate a nation. Dr. Yusef Benjakanan says, she's dipped in chocolate, bronzed in elegance, enameled in grace, toasted in beauty, my Lord, she must be a black woman. Had to be talking about you. Eleanor Roosevelt said, a woman is like a tea bag. You never know how strong she is until you put her in hot water. Had to be talking about you. So when I think about you, I think about, you know, all the things that you've done. But there was one moment that we want you to share with us. You were on your way. You were virtually one of the last people to see Dr. King alive in the city of Atlanta. You drove him to the airport to go to Memphis. Can you tell us about that day?
Well, it was first that Sunday, we were at their home. I was often there with the children and the family. But this particular Sunday, the children had left to go play. His mother was at his home for dinner. So we were all having fun, and Dr. King said, I bet you didn't know I could sing. And I said, well, no, I really don't know. I heard you could, but I've never heard you, so I don't know whether you can sing or not. And I'm an old piano player, and so he said, well, give me a B flat. And I gave him a B flat, and he sang, sound pretty decent. But then the afternoon went just like that. We were singing, we were just having a wonderful time. And more fun than usual when I thought, you know, reflect on it. But his mother, we took her home, and then I went home, and then I said, now I'll be here early in the morning. He was always late, always late. So I said, I said, now these planes don't care nothing about you. When the airplanes get ready to go, they go with or without you. And so I was over there early to pick him up. And the two boys, I mean, they saw their dad go in the airport
Dexter
all the time.
Martin,
And so it was not unusual, but this morning ended up being unusual because when I came in the door to retrieve him, the boys grabbed his briefcase and they said, Daddy, don't leave us. That had never happened. They saw him going to the airport all the time. Daddy, don't leave us. And then he ran and blocked the door so Dr. King couldn't get out. And then he finally was able to get out, and the other one ran in front of him and blocked the steps, but couldn't get down the steps. Daddy, please don't leave us. Daddy, please don't go. A plea unlike anything you've ever heard. Now, that was the most. They saw their dad going there. He was always going to the airport. Yes. Always going to the airport. Well, on the way, now that night, oh, I forgot this portion. About 11:30 at night, his mother called me. She said, I know you're going to take ML to the airport in the morning, but will you take advantage of this moment and ask him, could we had so much fun today, singing and playing the piano and just having a good time. She said, we could have more family gatherings like that. So will you tell him kind of help alter his schedule? Maybe you can help him alter his schedule so we can have a little more flexibility for us to have fun. Well, the kids now still got outside, and then they blocked the door where he couldn't get in. And he said, what is wrong with these kids? Well, then we finally were able to retrieve him from the door, but then they jumped on the hood of my car when I took
him.
I mean, unusual behavior. And I said, now, Dr. King, this is a new car. I just got this car. We got to get these kids off my car. But on the way to the airport, he was troubled by their behavior. And he said, have you ever seen them act like that? I said, no, because they never act like that. He said, well, I guess I'm going to really have to go to Memphis and turn around and come right back because I'm not leaving these children. They're telling me that I'm leaving them too much. So I want you to help me and anybody else help me with my schedule. Whether you do it or not, I'm going to stay home with these kids more. Last time I saw him. Well, I did see him again. Let me go into that. Now, you have to keep me on track, because, okay. But now he goes to Memphis, and you know the rest of the story. He was there, had the march. And then he called me that afternoon about 2 o'clock or so and said, I've changed rooms. Well, I had heard on the news that people were giving him a hard time because they moved him from a slum neighborhood to a better hotel.
Right.
And he said, but I don't know why my room seems so strange to me. I'm in room 306. And I said, oh, that's my address. And I said, you know, we're still connected, aren't we? I said, you know, you're in the room that's my room, and we laughed about it. Well, I didn't see him anymore. So you know the story. Well, they brought him to Atlanta once he was shot or killed. They brought him to Atlanta. And a lot of preparation took place. But let me just go jump to this one story. Once he now is killed, everybody in the world knows he's dead and he's not coming back. But people call from everywhere. They had to get telephone lines because everybody was calling. But Bobby Kennedy called. Now, everybody got through. The president called and all the important people were able to get through, but Bobby Kennedy couldn't get through. So about 10 o'clock that night, he got through and said to Mrs. King, who's your point person? He said, because I think you're going to need some assistance. So she told him that I was. He said, well, Xernona, I want you to take this information down. He said, we've been trying to call Mrs. King since it happened, 5 o'clock or so in Memphis. and he'd been trying to call and couldn't get through. He said, "We've ordered a plane for Mrs. King. We heard on the news that she wants to go to Memphis. So there's an airplane right now on the grounds of the airport, tailgate number 1234, pilot's name Jack Splats. It's there whenever you want. You don't have to call, just go to the airport." And so he's telling Mrs. King what she has to do because we got all these people expected to come to the funeral. He says, "Xernona, when morning comes, I want you to go downtown and contact every hotel manager in the city of Atlanta and tell them to not let any rooms through until you call." Well, hold that story. I saw the next morning, I was downtown, and I saw Sidney Poitier and John Johnson, who was an editor of Ebony and Jet, you know, a millionaire.
Right.
And so I said, "Now let me ask you all a question." I said, "Who do you think Black Power really is?" And he said, "What do you mean?" I said, "Well, I want you to know that Black Power is me." I said, "You all can't get a room, can't nobody get a room in this hotel, in this city, without coming through me. Now that's powerful, yeah."
You locked down all the hotels in
the
downtown area. Yeah.
They had to come through me.
They had to call you.
Now, and you think I'm an ordinary person, don't you?
No, ma'am. Not at all.
I'm a big shot. I'm a big shot. But on the day of viewing, it was in the papers that he would be available at 11 o'clock for the public to see him. I hadn't seen him, but I was with the family all the time, and it had begun to rain a little bit, and we were running late. Mrs. King's always late. But she said, because she was so compassionate, she said to the security guards, she said, "Well, go ahead and let them come in." I said, "No, Mrs. King, you should see him first. The public will wait."
That's right.
They don't care how long, they will wait. Boy, was that good advice. Because when we got over to Spelman, they let the family in. Now, Harry Belafonte, his wife, Dr. King's secretary, and I were the only non-family members. Everybody else was a member of the family. So they let the family in to view the body for the first time. Now, I kept my eye on Mrs. King, and when I saw her at the bier, she said, "Ugh." And I thought it was a shock of the fact now he really is dead. But when I got down there, he looked awful. And the right side of his jaw, look, I'd been beaten up and splattered. Oh my gosh.
He was shot in the neck.
So I walked quietly over to the mortician's representative, and I said this quietly, nobody could hear. I said, "Sir, is there anything you could do to the side of his face? It was big. Oh, it just looked awful." And then he said, crashly, "Miss, that's the best we could do. The jaw was blown off," loudly. The family heard this. I was so mad at him, I don't do it. I said, "Okay, he's crazy, so leave him over there." But I know at that time, women used to have loose powder in a compact. Almost every woman had that. Belafonte's wife was white, so I figured she had light powder. Mama King, who's Martin Luther King's mother, was dark, and I figured she had dark powder. So I was smart enough to say, "Julie, let me have your powder and Mama King's." And I went over to the beer and made myself a little roux of the combination of this and put it on his face and made all the difference in the world, brought us face down.
Wow.
Now here's my friend. He was my friend, my boss, my everything. I love Dr. King. And now here he is lying in a casket with his jaw blown off. That was a sight and an experience I'll never forget.
Ms. Clayton, you shared that when Ms. Coretta Scott King found out about Dr. King's passing, she had to go and tell the children. And you were with her when she went to tell the children. Can you tell me a little bit about that story?
It was very difficult time, needless to say, you know, for everybody. She was trying to hold up for the children's sake, for her other family's sake, for the nation's sake. And to see the weight on her shoulder, I ended up with a new respect for her, because she asked me to go in the children's room to tell them, because she didn't want anybody to tell them but her. And she took me with her, and she had a grip on my arm that was so strong that it hurt for, you know, several days. That's how she had challenges during those times, having to tell the children, having to tell the nation, having to tell, you know, everything. What I remember about that period of my life is that I ended up playing an important role in a very unpopular setting, because Dr. King was like a member of my family. I was like a member of their family. And to know that we live now, my mind went back to Nashville when the man said, "You don't belong here." I spent from that point to this point all of my life, trying to prove that, yes, this is my home. I was born here. I didn't choose to be black, but I'm here now, and I am black. And I'm going to join everybody else who's trying to make black be okay. So I remember that man from that point to this, that I do belong here. And I've spent my life. When you ask me what I've been doing, I desegregated or led the movement in Chicago when I lived there for the stores. The downtown stores were kind to black people to let us in, but they didn't hire anybody. Mm-hmm. Well, I fixed that. Mm-hmm. So desegregated that, Montgomery Ward, Spiegel, all those big stores in downtown Chicago, I did that. I spent my time in my life, and I tell people all the time, need not be selfish, because you're going to get the pleasure. Mm-hmm. Once you've accomplished something, that's a pleasure you just bestow on yourself.
Yes.
I did that.
That's right.
I made this possible. But just keep on doing it. Just keep on doing it. Don't stop. Just keep on doing it.
Don't stop.
Just one thing real quick, though. I'm sure you all hear the common theme between her about people being late.
Oh,
Ms.
Yeah.
Clayton has never been late. If she tells you, if you give her a time, she's going to probably beat it by 30 minutes. Still drives to work at 5 o'clock a.m. every morning. At 39 years of 93 years, 39, something like that, one of those. But time, and there's something for all of us in this, and I wish you'd just spend a little bit on why time is so important to you and why being on time, because that just seems to be a common denominator of us just being, you know, Pastor, we've taken great pride in being fashionably late. But that's not her.
No.
And if you tell her that the program starts at 8 o'clock, the program starts at 8 o'clock. She would tell you the program starts, even if she's not in place, it starts at 8, you started at 8. Why is time so important to you?
Well, because minutes to minutes, 60 minutes in an hour, you ain't got but so many hours. So if you spend your time all the time trying to get there, you ain't got time to do nothing once you get there. Time is up, you know. But when you really let people know you don't tolerate that, I mean, people aren't late with me anymore.
No, no.
Because I had a man, he didn't believe it. He had a 10 o'clock appointment with me. And I waited, I mean, I'm reasonable. I waited 5 minutes. But at 10:20, I went and locked my door.
That's right.
And then my assistant said, your appointment is here. I said, oh, really? I said, it's 10:25. I didn't have a 10:25 appointment. I had a 10 o'clock appointment. And it's past 10 o'clock now. She said, but you're not doing anything. I said, yes, I am. She said, what are you doing? I said, I'm counting my toes and picking my nose. I can do anything I want on my time. So I don't tolerate it. And people know that. So I don't really have much trouble now. People know.
All over the world, and they send you watches and clocks. Your office is filled with clocks. It's filled with timepieces because people know that you are a stickler for time.
Yes.
How did you get that way? You shared a story about your father.
Well, my father gave me a painful lesson. He said, and I'm gonna cut the story short, but I'm trying. All my stories get long, I know. I'm sorry about that,
You are fine.
But my father was a minister, and he had about 20 choir members. And this one Sunday, my sister and I got an invitation to go to, I was born in a small town, Muskogee, Oklahoma. You probably never heard of it. But going to Tulsa, Oklahoma was like going to New York, you know. But her father was a businessman and said, my dad told me to ask you all if you'd like to go to church, go to Tulsa. Well, I was supposed to be in church because I was directing the choir and supposed to be in there, but this trip to Tulsa sounded much more appealing than going to church. So we went to Tulsa. Well, I saw my father that night, and he was a soft-spoken man. He said, young lady, I said, young lady? And that hurt him because we loved our father. But for me, I had a name. What would call me young lady? I guess I was on my P's and Q's. He said, young lady, sit down. And I said, where? He said, right there on the floor. And he said, I want you to imagine a scale here. And so I could imagine the scale. He said, okay, we're going to put you on one side of the scale and your choir members on the other side. So Daddy made up some numbers to prove his point, because I didn't have but 20 members in the choir, but each of them, according to Daddy, all 20 of them were coming to the church that day. All of them had 4 children or more. When he got through, he had a cast of thousands, so now the scale is going dip, dip, dip. You know, I'm up on this end and they're over here. And he said, now look at that scale. Any balance in that? Well, no, sir. He said, now all of those people are inconvenienced because you wanted your moment of pleasure. Can you imagine how selfish that is? Well, to call me, I mean, my sweet darling daddy, we were partial to daddy. Daddy called me, selfish? That's the worst thing I figured I could be called, is to be selfish. I wasn't selfish. I was a giving person, I thought. And he pointed his finger, and I don't like today nobody point their finger in my face. Excuse me, I didn't mean to do that. But to this day, I don't want to be selfish. It's painful. He said, young lady, from this day forward. If you got a word, make it have meaning. If you tell somebody you're going to meet them at high noon on the corner to count blue cars going by, I don't care what you're doing, you meet them, because you don't know what they're going through to make the time frame that you recommended. So now you done got them all stirred up and you're not there? How selfish could that be? Well, that taught me a lesson, so that's why I can't be late. I don't want nobody running late with me, because I ain't selfish.
You're not late, and no one can be late with you.
Oh, yeah. Nobody.
I want to go back.
Pastor, she done fired volunteers for being late. She'll fire a volunteer.
Wow. I want to go back when you got the news that Dr. King was shot. You were at lunch with a gentleman, one of the grand dragons of the Ku Klux Klan.
No.
Literally.
Not one of them. He was the
grand dragon.
Grand dragon. That's the leader.
And this man changed his heart about black people because of you.
Yes.
Can you tell us how did you work your way into a man whose heart was so evil and so hateful? How did you work your way into his heart?
Well, he took the leadership. He would come to my office, always wore a suit, I must add, and sit down and said, "Miss Clayton, I just want to know you better." Okay, fine. Had a suit, tie on, looking like a gentleman. He wasn't one, but he looked like one. He said, "How many Negroes live in Detroit and own their own home?" I said, "I think first, let me correct, you're probably trying to say Negroes." That was during the time when we called ourselves that. Negroes, not Negroes, because that's too close to the other word.
Right.
And I said, "Oh, sir, I have no way of knowing that." He said, "Well, how many Negroes own their own home in Mississippi?" I said, "Change the word. It's not Negroes. What you're trying to say, Negro." And I said, "But I don't know." And he said, he laughed at me. He said, "You don't know, but let me tell you." He said, "There are more Negroes with their own homes in Mississippi than they got in Detroit. Because, see, they went from the south to north to get better life. And they ain't got no better life, because they do better down there on their own home." And I knew if I had to deal with him, he was making me mad. But I started asking him questions, since he done asked me a bunch of questions. I said, "You go to church?" He said, "Oh, yes, ma'am." And I said, "Oh, really? What kind of church you go to?" He said, "A Baptist church." I said, "Oh, I'm a Baptist." And he said, "What are you doing?" I asked him, "What do you do in church?" He said, "I'm chairman of the deacon board." I said, "Chairman of the deacon board? And you come up here on Friday nights and pick up your two children and they put on white robes and they go out to Stone Mountain to do bodily harm? What kind of church is that? That allows you to stand before them with God in your heart and evil right beside it, and mistreating people? What kind of treatment you get out of that?" Well, that's the way our conversations went all the time.
And he was,
all the time.
I mean, he was a grand dragon, so this was,
he I
was
mean,
the
grand
guy.
Dragon, I mean, he was the president, the, you know, the chief, the head of all of them. And he said, I said, "Well, Mr. Craig, that doesn't seem to match." I said, "Because from what I know about church, you're supposed to make you a better person, and you stand, you know, represent God. And you stand there before the congregation with hatred in your heart, you're going out doing bodily harm. and teaching your children how to do it. Oh, Mr. Craig, that done said well with me. Well, I had, in the meantime, I was getting men calling me at my office, like, could I take you to lunch? And I said, well, sir, I don't go to lunch with men. I don't know. I don't even know you. He said, well, I have to meet you. And I had those kinds of calls. People had to meet me. These were white men who had to meet with me. I said, why? He said, because I'm a friend of Calvin Craig. And he talks so much about you in a favorable light that I want to see for myself if you're really black. And I said, well, I'm really black, but I ain't going to lunch with you, you know. Well, one day on a Saturday, I went shopping, came home, and I lived on a quiet street at the time, and I saw all these cars look like they were in front of my house when I turned the corner. The mayor was there, the police cars, and everybody was lined up in front of my house. And I thought, oh, God, what in the world has happened? Well, it turned out this Calvin Craig had a press conference earlier that day and announced that he was coming out of the Klan and credited a black woman with changing his whole attitude. And I was that black woman.
Wow. And you remain friends with his family.
Oh, yes. And his daughter flew down here from Washington just to meet me because her dad talked so much about me. And then when he died, his wife called and asked, would I come to the funeral and would I have dinner with her? I was scared to eat. But we got sacks of mail like this in the mayor's office. The mayor's office delivered 3 trips to my office every day with mail that came from all over the world.
Wow.
Inviting us to appear on television in Romania, this place I never even heard of. But guess what? He would say, well, Miss Clayton, this sounds like a good invitation. Will you go with me? Oh, no. I ain't going all the way to Romania with you, I'll tell you. But that was a pivotal point in my life where they wrote a play about it, and I got so many converts, people who came and said, you know, you're responsible for our change. I think the Klan's still around. I don't have no friends anymore in the organization. But that's a high moment in my life.
So after, and then.
Oh, wait, let me tell you. I did go with him to a radio station here in Atlanta. It was a call-in show, so people were live, you know, call-in. And I did go with him, made that appearance with him. And this black man said, who was now the caller, said, I don't know why y'all making such a big story about this. That, you know, colored women go to bed with white men all the time, so ain't nothing special about this story. Well, I said to him, to Mr. Craig, wanted to respond, don't respond to ignorance. You know, that's ignorance. But he walked me to my car, it was at nighttime, and he said, I feel like I want to cry because I put you in a bad light. I said, listen, having a man say he's going to bed with, they ain't bad. I ain't going to bed with, I don't even know who it was. Maybe I might have, I should have inquired as to who it was, but anyway, I didn't. But I said, you see, we have ugly people in our society, just like you used to be one. So that man is thinking ugly things that I'm going to bed with you just because he's ugly. And I said, so when you're ugly, you know, you're likely to do anything. So I said, so change and stay changed, you know.
Change and stay changed. We actually have pictures of him. I don't know if we have it queued to put on the screen or not, but we probably don't have it queued just yet. I want to take us to, Dr. King is passed. You leave Atlanta shortly afterwards and you move to California. What did you go to California to do?
Well, at the time, my husband, my first husband, I had so many, I have to number them. No. I got a wonderful husband. I'm just joking.
I know.
And on that point, I'd like for you, he's ill now, and I'd like for you all to send up a prayer for him.
We will.
We will have been married 50 years in a month or two.
In a couple months.
And I didn't think I was going to hang around that long, so I'm really surprised about this wedding repose. But what was your question?
You moved to California, and you got involved in the television industry. And just wanted to hear a little bit about that and how you came to meet Ted Turner at CNN.
Well, they come later, but while I was in California, my first husband was the editor of Jet and Ebony magazines, and everybody knows about Jet and Ebony, and had a good salary, and so we lived large. We lived in Los Angeles, and because of the magazine, the movie industry wanted to change its image, like they're now having black people like Belafonte and performers integrate, the houses of enjoyment and all. And so I got a chance to meet them. I said, you know what? I met June Allison and Dick Powell and Jane Mansfield and all those people. I said, we could have a fundraiser at their house, and that would just draw our black community over. We could send the money to Atlanta for a civil rights struggle. And I did real well with that. And so they ended up like, they consider Monday night as dark night, that celebrities don't work on Monday nights. So they'd all end up at my house, to eat and drink and have a good time. And I would make more contact. So I was living large. I was kind of like running Hollywood, so to speak. And sending the money down here, because I'd never been to Atlanta before. And felt good supporting the movement without having to live here. And I proved the point, you don't have to live here, to get rid of segregation. You don't have to live there. But we moved because Dr. King called, and my husband was very talented, unusually talented, but a little cocky, And so he knew he was good. But every place Dr. King went looking for a good writer and a good PR person, they said, well, this guy, Ed Clayton, is good, but he'll let you know it real quickly. But finally, Dr. King called and asked us to move to Atlanta. And I said, shoot, I'm running Hollywood. I don't want to move, And then he said, Dr. King said, well, if you'll just move, I'll see that you get a new car, a new house, a housekeeper, and nice change. And guess what? We finally moved. I got none of that. I said, now, everybody knows Martin Luther King is a Christian, but I hate to tell him, he don't always tell the truth. I was waiting for that housekeeper, that cook, I didn't know how to do all of that.
Ms. Clayton. How did you feel? We got a lot of people over here who were really, Pastor, really instrumental in the statue, right? And we're talking about, Denise and I, it's the 1 year anniversary. How did you feel that day to see the statue unveil? That was such an amazing day.
Well, they're responsible But let me tell you how I really felt. I got up that morning. I knew they were going to haul in the statue to have it in place before people start moving around, because it's right downtown across from the Hyatt. And so since I get up early, I said, I'm going to go over there, and I don't know what time they're coming. Well, Karen is here. She's the one responsible. And she told us that they were going to move in about 7 or 8 o'clock. Well, I was up, went over there, waited. And guess what? And I still remember the sight. When the truck drove up, I could see some legs hanging out of the truck. But I kind of looked like my feet, you know? And then when the head came out, I said, oh, it is I. It is I. And I tell you, it was a feeling like, oh, that's an artificial me, but it's really me. And I haven't cried like that since I was a baby. I mean, here I was, and I have to say this, modulating what I'm saying to you, because I don't want to appear like I'm, well, I am. But I knew what this meant. Is that the statue up there? I knew what this meant, that they'd already named a street after me and a park, and now this. And here I'm going to be a symbol of whatever that represents. Mm-hmm. And then I prayed, I cried to myself, stood behind the tree so no one could see me cry, and I cried like a baby. That here's going to be my image. But you know, then I ended up saying to myself, well, that means I got to be a better person. Mm. I got to be sure I'm doing the right thing by other people.
Yes.
And then I want to sublimate any vanity, like I think I'm cute. Well, I ain't too bad, am I, guys? Guys? I don't think that. And let me tell you what I do think. I do think that with an image that's supposed to be positive, I have to be good.
That's right.
I have to be good.
I wish so many people could hear that statement. Visibility demands accountability.
Yes.
The more visible you are, the more accountable you should be. Your life has got to earn the stage that you sit on.
Yeah.
That's a good word.
You said it so well. You said it so well. But, you know, I've got friends sitting right there. They're not putting on a show for you. They do this all the time. They go where I go, and Nathan, my assistant, lets them know where I'm going. Mm-hmm. They show up mm-hmm. to support me. Mm-hmm. That's what friends do.
Yeah.
Support you. Now, I don't think they talk about me behind my back. But you know what? I don't care. They talk about me even more than, but if they keep showing up and supporting me,
that's right.
I don't care what else they do.
That's right.
I'm going to be kind to them and thankful to that's them. Right. But I don't care what else they
do. They show up because they love you. I am speaking of people that are just in love with your character, your heart, and that you've touched. I got the times mixed up. You were in California first, and then in Atlanta. I got it mixed
right.
up. I apologize. But then you met...
As good looking as you are, you can get it mixed up. I told your wife that I want you all to know that I choose. I don't let men choose me. I do the choosing. So So I picked boyfriends all over the country, all over the world. I got boyfriends that I choose. And if they look all right and act all right, they mine. They mine.
So at one event, she had all of, they asked for all of Miss Clayton's boyfriends to stand up. She said half of the men in the room all stood up.
And then I also told them that one woman snatched her husband. Boy said, oh, you don't know that woman. And then my husband told a man said, you know, I really love your wife. He said, I'd like to steal her and take her home with me. He said, you don't have to steal her. You can just have her. He said, because one thing, you can't bring her back once you take her, because that's a mean woman. She's awful to live with, you know.
I doubt it. Yeah. So at CNN, what was your role at CNN, and how did you and Ted Turner establish such a lifelong friendship?
The most beautiful relationship. But you know what? I've been blessed. When I take a retrospective look at my life, all the relationships, I've never gotten in trouble. But, you know, I can't have all these boyfriends. But you know what? They love it. Like, I've never had a wife run into me because they know I ain't playing. I'm just playing. And I tell them, man, listen, I'm just joking. You know, ain't nothing to me but talk.
We know.
But there's something about the way you carry yourself with people that it's not a problem for me to have boyfriends because they ain't going nowhere. I'm a happily married woman.
Yes.
A happily married woman. And I don't need men to validate me. I try to take care of my own reputation. I don't
need
no
man. Say that again. I don't need men to validate me.
No, I don't need no man to give me, you know, recommendations or. I'm going to be the woman I want you to know I am. I'm a decent woman, an honest woman, and I'm going to be right by folks. So I don't need to go through all that. I'm nothing but mouth. You know, I just talk, you know. And all my men and all their wives know it.
Yes.
I ain't going to nobody's husband, you know. Well, a couple of them look pretty good, though, you know. But seriously, and what was your question?
Ted Turner, yes, coffee and...
I think that's one... I've been blessed. I start to say he's one of my great blessings, but he is. I was the first black person to ever have a television show in all of the South.
Before Oprah.
Oprah. Yes.
Xernona Clayton.
Exactly.
Was Xernona Clayton.
I had a successful show. Yes. And being on television, you know, attracts kooks. You know, so everybody wants to know who you are and all that. Well, I had led and had a wonderful reputation in the industry that I got offers even. Barbara Walters called me to New York to possibly, you know, appear with her, but she was getting ready to retire. I didn't play around on television, and I did a good job, won awards and all that, and had made my name in the industry. And the main thing that I like to brag about is that I got other black women in the industry all over the country.
That's right.
But after 9 years, I figured I'd had enough. And by then, my first husband had passed away, and I had been single for about 5 years and met Ed. And I decided, I just got married, let my husband take care of me, and I decided I'll try something else. And so I ended my career when my contract was up for that particular year. Well, Ted Turner was doing funny television, you know, humorous television, and they decided they wanted to go serious. And I don't know how they found out. I turned in my resignation, and in about an hour, I got a call from this station. So I guess everybody knows what you're doing in the industry. And they said, I hear you. You've left Channel 5. And where are you going? I said, I'm home. You know, I got a new husband. I'm going to let him feed me for a while. But they asked me to come over to the station and asked me to work for them. And I said, well, no, I don't plan to work right now. And they said, well, just come and be with us. Do you know they paid me to sit in an office with nothing but a telephone and a desk and think. They just wanted me a part of their network.
They paid her to think.
Yeah.
Your mind is more valuable than anything else that you have.
Because that's the best job I ever had, because I didn't have to do nothing but just get the check. But they were now going serious television, and I gave them three suggestions for shows. The first one I gave them won an Emmy. And in television, when you win an award, you're in. And so then now they're locking me in that office now. They wouldn't let me get out. So I did another one. So now I'm there. And all I'm doing is sitting there wondering where I'm going to go shopping today, you know, when I leave here, with nothing to do except just think. And so I was giving them program ideas. And then they had an opening for what we call a fair play job. And I didn't even apply for it, but I got hired anyway. So that was to stabilize the staff, you know, be sure we had balance of blacks and whites. And Ted Turner was not doing it himself, but the way we got connected so personally is he was in California when, what's the guy who got beaten so badly, the black guy?
Rodney King.
Rodney King, you know, we were losing people here at the station because they were white, they got beat up outside and all that. Well, I called Ted Turner, who was in California on a business trip, and now here I am just a lowly person. You know, I guess they said I'd act like I was trying to run the show or something, but I said I'd like to speak to Mr. Turner when he calls, and I asked his secretary. I said, Mr. Turner, you need to be here. The staff would rather hear what you have to say about us, because now they were killing people right outside the building, you know. Everybody was in danger. I said, the place is gonna, you know, fall apart. You're the leader. You need to be here to tell all of us we're gonna be okay or whatever. And he thought I had a lot of nerve because I wasn't one of the big shots at that time. I later became one, but I wasn't one then. But he said, well, okay. He came home and called a meeting with all of us to say we're going to put up some safeguards. And it was the best thing that could have happened to us because we all felt now we were safe. We had no more killings. And then they moved me up to another position. Then I got to be the first black person with a real job. I mean, I became a board member and with stock. Which I'm still getting some stock right now. but he believed in me from that point on. And he listened to me from that point on. And I don't think that I was the smartest person, but I had a slant of being black. I mean, I know how black folk are always in danger.
You weren't afraid.
You know, that's right.
You
I wasn't afraid.
Afraid.
No, not at all. And I didn't treat him like a white boss. I mean, he just happened to be the boss, the one who could make a decision. And I was fearless about it. I never felt afraid to speak up. And that's how I got moved up, 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 you know.
I hate to end this this interview. It has been a blessing. It has really been a blessing. Thank you. Thank you. Clayton, can we pray for you? Lord, I just want to ask your grace over this precious and dear woman. Thank you for the circles and the rooms that you've allowed her to be in. Thank you for the experiences that you've allowed her to have and the blazing trail that she blazed for so many other women. I pray your grace over her for another 93 years. Touch her, her life, her heart. Thank you for the example that she set, that she's a model for young women to follow. Lord, I give you praise for the strength and the grace you've given to her. Now, Lord, I pray for her husband. Oh, God, I really pray that you would touch him. As he is dealing with a small illness, I know that you are a healer. Would you keep him, Lord? Raise him up, strengthen him in Jesus' name. Thank you for the life of Xernona Clayton and the impact she's had on so many and us today. How we love you for her life in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Are we still on? I told your wife that if you don't come home one night, to just call me.
Okay. Baby, I'm coming home. I promise you, I'm coming home. I promise you. I think that's the first time that's ever happened. I think that's the first time that's ever happened. Help me say thank you to Xernona Clayton. Let's all stand. So we live in a world where the images of our role models are all wrong. They're all wrong. I am going to make a lot of people angry, and I don't want to make you angry, but I want you to listen to me, please. These are my opinions. You may not share the same opinions. Every time when I look at, I'll do it nicely, when I look at a modern day female entertainer, my heart breaks. The way they're dressed, the skimpiness, the provocative sexuality. Many of them can't sing. But it's the physical image that people flock to. So listen to me, don't leave, listen to me. We glorify young ladies on a stage for doing the same thing we tell our daughters not to do. We celebrate them on a stage dressed as they are, dancing as they are, and we tell our children, don't do that. And our kids have no role models. I listen to some of the songs that our children listen to. Degrading, denigrating women and femininity. Calling women out of their name. And it's not just the men who are doing it. It's other women who are doing it as well.
We have no role models. We have very few role models. I was so proud of Barack and Michelle Obama. So proud of them. Not because of their politics. We can argue and disagree about policy and politics all day. But here's a black man and a black woman who love each other, have a healthy family. Here is a first lady who is honorable, who is dignified, who is strong, who's full of strength. So many people wondered, why are we doing this today? Because I want to present new images before our young girls so they can see there is a different and a better way. There's a better way. You had before you a legend. You had before you someone who didn't become a legend overnight. Her story started in a humble space, and God took her from one stage to the next stage, the next stage. The part that you didn't hear that we didn't get into was that in every one of those seasons of Miss Clayton's life, she was a servant. She served Dr. King. She served at CNN. She served the public with her television shows. She served. We didn't talk about trumpet awards. She served. She served. She served. She served. You see, you can be great and serve. You don't have to be at the top. The Bible says that the servant shall be first. That if you're going to be greatest among them, you must first be a servant. And today, there's a statue that bears her image and her name in downtown Atlanta with a street named after her. Not because she made millions and billions or wrote books, but because she was willing to serve. When you're humble, God will exalt you. When you are willing to be low, God will take you high. All you got to do is show up. So if you're a young lady listening to me, you are more than your body. You are more than your sex appeal. You are more than your sensuality. You are a daughter of God. You are a chosen young woman of God. God has destined you for greatness. Don't let anybody denigrate you or demoralize you. Stand tall in who you are. Study like you would in any other class. Be the valedictorian and the salutatorian. Get degrees and scholarships to go to college. You don't have to be a boy or a man to be great. You can be great no matter who you are, where you come from. If God be for you, he is more than the world against you. We need more fathers. More men to stand up and teach our daughters what it means to be a lady, what it means to be a woman, what it means to be strong. So I'm grateful to God that we had this interview today. Help me say thanks to God one more time. As we prepare ourselves to be dismissed, I want to do two things. One is, if you're in the room and you never gave your life to Jesus Christ, I want to tell you that the Lord Jesus loves you. He loves you more than you could imagine. He loves you no matter what you've done, where you've come from, or what your experiences have been. Jesus never turns his back on you. He loves you because he died for you. He loves you because the Father made you, and the Father made you in his own image. You are exactly who he wants you to be. You live exactly the life that he's called you to have. If you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, all you got to do is say yes to the Lord Jesus. That's all you got to do is say yes to him. And he will come into your heart and into your life. If you're in this room or if you're online and you've never given your life to Christ, I want you quickly to get out of your seat,
Find the closest aisle that you can and meet me down here at this altar. And come, let's get this right with God today. Secondly, if you're here and God told you to join this church and you know that this is home, you're fully and well aware that this is home. You've been coming for a while. You've been hanging out here, but you've never stepped across the line. You've been dating us, but you have not yet gotten married. Well, today is the day for you to go on ahead and walk the aisle and let's get married. If you're here and God's told you that this is your house, this is your home, this is your church, get out of your seat and meet me right down here. Hey, baby, get out of your seat and meet me right down here. Come on and give God praise for these who are making up their mind. Bless you. Bless you. Come on. Come on. Somebody give the Lord praise. Give the Lord praise. Hallelujah. If you're here, make your way. If you're online watching, God placed you in front of this screen. And if you're still here, that means that something valuable was deposited in your heart today. Maybe you've been watching for a while and worshiping with us for a while, but never joined our community. We have live leaders and ministers waiting right now in a special Zoom room to minister to you, pray with you, and help encourage you to go deeper into what it means to be a member of this church. Amen. God bless you, brother. And so if you're online watching, take a moment, copy that link in your chat space, and put it in your browser. If you're not using a computer and looking at this on a television, just grab your phone right quick. Grab your phone. Go to our online live stream. It's on our website. And copy and paste that link and put it in your browser. And there's a live leader waiting to talk with you on Zoom. You can leave your camera off and just turn your heart on. Amen? Come on, let's give God praise in this place. Oh, you can do better than that. Bless the name of the Lord. All right, we're getting ready to go home. We wanted to have a moment for you all to get a chance to meet Miss Clayton, but this is a COVID era, and we did not want to expose her to any danger. So I ask you for your forgiveness, but we will not be able to have you to get a chance to meet her. She's such a gracious person. If we were, she would talk to every single one of you until the last person. So please forgive us. And we'll bring her back, and you'll have a chance to meet her and do all the picture things and all that stuff. Amen. Amen. All right. All right. Father, I thank and praise you for who you are and for all that you mean in our life. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your love and your mercy over us. Thank you for a good day. Thank you for a good, good day. Father, I pray that something was said and done today that will inspire a young lady or even a young man to not take for granted the special moments you've placed in their lives, to not argue and complain about the seasons that they're in, but to blossom in every season and to see every obstacle as an opportunity. I pray, God, that you'd help us live lives where we make the most out of life. And we give your name praise. To the only wise God, our Savior, be majesty, dominion, and power. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and be gracious unto you and grant you his peace. In your rising and your setting, your coming and your going, today and for the rest of your life, in Jesus' name, amen and amen again. I love you all so, 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 so much. Love you very much. God bless you. Don't forget, get registered for the 5K race. Get registered. Love you. Bye-bye.
What an amazing time with Mrs. Xernona Clayton. She was phenomenal. I hope that you remember this week to serve, to be on time, and to be humble, to walk in humility. We know that we can do all of these things with Christ, walking the journey out of humility, of service. My hope, my prayer is that you take that on this week. If you haven't already joined the virtual online community, please do so. There's a link in the chat that will allow you to become a part of our eCampus. Also, if you'd like to give your life to Christ, there is a Zoom link that will take you to a Zoom room for you to connect with leaders from our church. Before we depart, let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for this amazing service, this time to be empowered by an icon, someone, one of your daughters that has poured so much into communities. And we just pray that we take from her light, that we serve, and that we are humble, and that we obey the instructions that you have given us. I pray that you have a peaceful week. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen again.